Good evening, everybody. My name is Dane Clausen. For those of you who don't know me, I have the distinction of being the James Pettis Professor of Communication here at Teal. I'm very glad to have joined Teal back in July, and looking forward to a great year in the Communication Department and elsewhere on campus. Tonight is the first event of the 2015-16 academic year, sponsored by the Pettis Fellows and the Pettis Communication Center and the community and the Pettis Chair. And we're very pleased tonight to have one of our own, Professor Ross Nugent, giving us a fine talk tonight. He will provide a historical overview on cinematic editing from the early days of motion pictures to today's use of mobile devices to capture and edit images. He will show how editing images is a critical element of time-based media language and explore the psychological effects of editing related to the creation of meaning in narrative and documentary films. Nugent, who teaches film, television, and other courses here at Teal College, has won many awards for his own documentary films, which have been shown in film festivals and art exhibitions around the world. His talk tonight, A Blink of the Eye, Mechanics and Meaning in Film and Video Editing. And I'm very pleased to introduce Ross. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Dr. Clausen, for the introduction. And I'm really excited to have a discussion with you all tonight. A lot of fun putting this project together. Forces me to do some editing myself, thinking about still images and moving images. I'm going to set something else up here, and I'll share a quick anecdote. One of my favorite regional filmmakers is a filmmaker by the name of Tony Buba, based in Braddock, steel town just outside of Pittsburgh. I've run into him occasionally, and he'll say, you know, "Hey, Ross, how's it going? What are you doing tonight in class?" And I say, "Oh, we're gonna go over editing." He said, "Oh, you're gonna teach them editing tonight?" Yeah. Well, if you figure it out, let me know. I've only been trying for 30 years. And it's true, you know, and at first I was a bit crestfallen, but it's true that I'm constantly working on editing, thinking about images, juxtaposition, collision, combinations. The first lights here. Let's keep that on. The first set of moving images here are actually a very explicit series of still images. We'll take a look here at the beginning and maybe a little bit at the end. This is a project called 256 Colors. Was a crowdsourced project by two filmmakers, primarily photographer and a video artist based in Chicago, Eric Fleischhauer and Jason Lazarus. This is from 2013. It's a feature-length film, it's silent, and it's entirely composed of animated GIFs. I refuse to call them GIFs. That were crowdsourced, right? So they put a call out and they received nearly 4,000 of these short animations. And it really brings the idea of cinema sort of back to its beginnings, right? Very short duration, limited motion. Of course, we have a little bit of our sort of tongue-in-cheek computer references when we first saw here at the beginning. To sit and see this film in an audience with the crowd in its entirety for 84 minutes is really something. You start to think about time and these combinations of images. And just to reiterate, each of these was submitted by another filmmaker artist. They gave them essentially a sort of how-to listing of how to put these images together. So let me... So while I had initially thought about sort of a broad historical overview, I think I want to focus a little bit on a little bit more on early cinema, partly because cinema is so new, right? As we'll see, you know, very new, right? It's a sort of short history. That isn't that far removed from our current experience in this space, sitting with an audience, looking at a screen, right? And also, I think we're a little detached. We have a little more critical distance, I think, from historical silent black and white. We can really see some explicit choices, decisions, and I brought some film along too, and we could have a little tactile experience maybe in a little bit. I think about cinema and its relationship from the last thing you just watched to its early beginnings, and we'll look at some of sort of proto-cinema. So my interest in thinking about film, and in particular tonight thinking of discussing media literacy, is that we are, on one hand, thinking about all the things that film does, film and video, whether, in this case, we'll talk a lot about cinema, but that will also carry over to work that you all are making or experience, whether it's news media, whether it's a presentation such as this. So I always tell students, when we start to think about shooting and editing, that it's all lies, right? Oftentimes you'll hear, but that doesn't look right. That's not how, you know, that's not how we would actually move in this space. So I think, well, you know, anytime we put a frame around something, and so we're cutting things out, right, in our composition, but also the way that we edit, leave some things on the right proverbial cutting room floor and include others. So we have this salacious film here of Edison's The Kiss, which we can take a look at here in a little bit. So you saw this succession of images, right? The images don't really move, right? It's a succession of still images, and then as they're projected. So it's this illusion of movement. We also, of course, have this illusion of space and depth, this extended depth of field here in Citizen Kane. Everything in the foreground, mid, and background in critical focus. We think about Ozu's approach to filmmaking, to cinematography, and I'm sure if we look at this image for a few seconds, can come up with some meaning there, regardless of lacking sound or movement. So we think about ways that we can communicate that way. Also, of course, sound. We won't talk too much about sound tonight, but of course we want to include that. I really love this still. For those of you who've not seen Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing, it has a relationship to some of the other editing techniques that we'll look at a little later, and it also has this very explicit direct address to camera throughout the film to engage the audience. In this case, the character Radio Raheem is giving us a story about life, love and hate, with right very literally, but also that's one of the key themes of the film, is that we're in particular, limited to a few blocks in Brooklyn, and dealing with issues of sex and violence and love and class and race. And it's very theatrical, but I really like that still there. So, right, of course, we need our minds. That's where we all come in, right, to sort of bring these ideas together. We're thinking about cinema. I really like presenting early cinema devices. Again, I think it gives us some critical distance, but also speaks to the sort of initial impulse to create images and to present images, and we'll see a few approaches. So we think of magic lantern shows. Maybe some of you have seen these magic lanterns. Date back to 16th century astronomer, designed just as you would use a device to capture light. You can also project that same way. So this idea that we're, you can see here, sort of seated facing the screen, and I like the idea of there being some tomfoolery in the background, right? The filmmaker as a show person, the filmmaker is coming from vaudeville, really, so that sort of entertainment, right? Here's some other proto-cinema devices that you may have had an opportunity to play with. Or make your own, some of these devices. Flip books, of course, would fit into that. So we think about making images. Early photography, as you see here, we see these early images. Everybody looks rather stoic in these portraits where they're seated, right? Usually due to the fact that they are literally strapped to boards. So their heads wouldn't droop for these long exposures that they would need, right? So we move from still photography as the photochemical emulsion as becomes a little more sensitive to a series photography. I think this image here has become iconic. Basically, Muybridge was working in still photography, San Francisco Bay Area, doing land surveying and scientific research, and then became interested in animal and human locomotion. So you may have seen these grids. So the story goes there was a bet as to whether or not all four hooves left the ground when a horse was in its full gait. It seems absurd to us now, right? Because we just have to watch a Anheuser-Busch commercial and see close-ups of the class. But to not have media that you would be able to record and play back and analyze, again, I think is sort of important to think about. So we have this silly device here, which again is a serial photography, right, that this disc would spin, perhaps where the idea of shooting film came from. So George Eastman, part of the Eastman Kodak company, 1889, essentially develops film strip that is flexible, and also the emulsion, the light-sensitive material, is fast enough to move in succession. And here, of course, Thomas Edison and his assistant, W.K.L. Dixon, have the kinetograph and the kinetoscope. So film strip here, running between a series of rollers, right, that would sort of run up one step right up, one person at a time, pay your nickel, look into this device. Edison was not interested in projecting to a mass audience. How would you make any money doing that? His approach was to sort of limit access and availability and presentation. So you may have heard of the Black Mariah. This is was developed in 1893. This is actually the world's first movie studio. So it's a tar paper covered shack. It still exists. And it's on a track here, right? So it's heliotropic, right? We can spin this whole room for that fantastic sunlight that New Jersey is known for. And the trap doors will open up. And the Black Mariah was a slang term for police paddy wagon. Just outside of Paris, France, around the same time, we have the Lumiere brothers, who were created a device that both captured and projected film, and fell in line more with the vaudeville approach. Their early films were all slice of life films, right? The arrival of a train, right? Workers leaving the factory. So there, it's a documentary impulse to capture the world in that way. So let's take a look at some of these real quick. Single reels, right? Action, that would be the full take. Again, thinking of the sort of peep show approach, we have this sort of dancing, we've had boxing, other things that you could imagine a sideshow barker, as opposed to watching a train come at the camera, right? This image, hand tinted, so using an aniline dye to add color to the film. So we move into sort of early cinema, again, the sort of documentary. And then thinking now, moving into, a little bit of sort of exposition, and then moving into visual storytelling, right? Really wanting to reiterate this idea that the immediate thought wasn't, let's make short stories, right? And that's sort of where editing comes in. Those of you may have seen Hugo, that was introduced in an earlier slide, is Martin Scorsese's homage to Georges Méliès. So while we have Edison and Lumiere brothers, Méliès is also working just outside of Paris. He is a tinkerer. He comes from a theater background and hears about this device, thinking about ways that he can document his theatrical presentations, as opposed to Edison's tar-covered Black Mariah. he shot across the pond in a greenhouse, essentially, as we would know to be a greenhouse, totally clear to take advantage of the available light. He was already running a successful theater troupe. So one of the first narrative films, right, one of the first short stories that's presented is Méliès' A Trip to the Moon in 1902. Everything in the background is hand-painted, right? He's interested in the fantastic, and he's also interested in trick photography, right? He went and approached the Lumiere brothers about purchasing their device, and they didn't believe that there was a future in cinema, moving images, and refused to sell it to him. So he would go to shows and peek and look and listen, and build his own camera. Trip to the Moon, it's still shot from a single perspective. So it's looking at a stage, essentially. There are different scenes that come in. The camera doesn't move. There aren't any close-ups. There aren't any cutaways. As things are developing here in the States, Edwin S. Porter, worked for Edison, came from lighting, essentially, and was an actor, started directing some of his own films. And we see in 1903 this really crude film called Life of an American Fireman. And what happens is we see the same action twice. We see the fireman dozing off at the station, and in the vignette here, mother putting a daughter down for bed. There's a fire in the house. We see from inside of the house the fire chief climbing through the window, rescue. The very next shot shows the exact same action from the outside of the house. We watch it today, and it's really confusing. We just think, what's going on? But they're almost there. They haven't quite figured out editing, right? They're not quite there. So when we're thinking about approach to editing and storytelling, of course, we have parallel editing, right? The primary idea, the primary sort of go-to definition is think about your chase scene, right? To just describe it logically doesn't make sense that we would think that these two things on the screen, right, are occurring at the same time, but through editing, pacing, rhythm, we do. Continuity editing is creating a believable space within a scene, right, within the same space. So cutting on action. So our traditional, our classical Hollywood narrative approach. Later that same year, Porter produces The Great Train Robbery, an early Western, includes this fantastic chase, it's the first time we see this parallel editing technique. I always think it's important to bring up D.W. Griffith. You may have heard his name. There's been a little bit of coverage this last year about The Birth of a Nation, the difficulty of including this in an academic setting. This film, a sprawling epic film, sort of quintessential example of both parallel editing, continuity editing. It takes place over a number of years. Had an earlier name, title as The Klansman, and essentially it's a revisionist history of potential outcome of Civil War. Technically it's a good teaching point, but it's a real challenge to teach it and not bring up some of the obvious issues. So I always like to include that because often in these sorts of lectures you'll have reference to this film. So as I mentioned, classical Hollywood narrative, these are all things that we've come to know. Sort of the four main rules here. Of course, chronological order and this strong degree of closure. It's a really sort of time and cause and effect. And of course, I have a still here from Pulp Fiction, noted, among other things, for creative use of narrative time, right? Things are presented out of order, and it adds something to the sort of pulp experience or narrative. And then also challenges our sort of expectations, right? I bring those things up now because I think we're all a fair bit familiar with some of those rules, right? We take them for granted, whether it's in Hollywood narrative or car commercial, right, or a news report. But a lot of these techniques and approaches were developed various places throughout the world, but in terms of editing, most notably Soviet montage editing. And I gotta say, I've sat through as a student of more than a few of these presentations about Soviet montage, and I thought I had it figured out, and then when I started making work, I didn't. I realized I didn't have it figured out at all. I could write about it, but I didn't quite get it. I'm still trying to get there, as I said. We all know sort of the montage sequence as they're applied in a traditional narrative form, right? Often a musical soundtrack. So we have a break from a traditional narrative in terms of time. Shots one after another. Usually we see our main character training for the big event. Shows time, sort of condensed. It notes change, right? And partly due to the ability to all of a sudden in a narrative film include 50 shots, right, in a minute and a half. So the effect that can have on a 90-minute, 180-minute film, depending on where you land with that. So one of the critical elements to thinking about editing and this collision, or often as it's termed, as opposed to building blocks, right, is that we have one image and another image. Either of those images on their own don't have any meaning, right? But when they come together, it's that collision, that's where the idea comes forth, is what's proposed. So the original experiment has been sort of lost to time, but there's been many similar approaches or similar experiments, right? And these, there were sort of competing theorists and practitioners in Russia that would battle for years about whether or not editing was based on this collision or through building blocks, right? So this sort of brick by brick or collision. I think it's collision. That's where I land with this, but I could be wrong. So this experiment would have been a projected image. We would see this fine-looking fellow here with a very plain look on his face. And then there would be a shot in this case, a child in a casket. This was really what they included in the experiment. And essentially, we're using like a control group, an audience, to report back what what he was feeling, what he was thinking, right? And then the next shot would be used. It'd be the same shot. And then there would be, right, here we have this guy looking at a bowl of soup. Well, he must be hungry, right? And then, of course, in this case, a woman in repose. I mean, even now, just as I like describe it and explain it and look at those things, it's hard to not associate or read into his facial characteristics, his eyes, his expression, or lack of, and apply some sort of meaning to it. So let's take a short pause here and pull up another image. And all right, so I'm going to keep this up in the background as we go. So this is from Eisenstein's Battleship Potemkin. This is sort of building up to the classic Odessa Steps sequence. Eisenstein followed the Kuleshov school of thought. This was often noted as the most widely recognized, maybe most successful propaganda films. It's not a true representation of what happened. And you've probably seen some of these sequences cribbed, played out in other films and other media, whether it's being lampooned. But essentially, what had happened in the film was there was a mutiny of the Navy as they had docked, essentially, sort of representing the proletariat. The townspeople come to support them, and the Tsar sends in troops, and massacre ensues. What we want to pay attention to is camera angle, shot size, reactions, and the idea was to create a stir. This is referencing the revolution of 1905, and this was released in 1925. So it was Eisenstein's thesis, right, of testing this experiment. So while we're looking at this, we've got a few minutes here. I recognize that a lot of us probably don't have a sort of casual relationship with film strips and editing. Probably a decent relationship with images, with that device you have in your pocket. But when we think about film, the sort of tactile, here's a magnifying glass there. So we again, reiterating this idea of discrete series of images, right? So when these folks are editing, they're not doing so with Vine. They're not doing so with any other program on their mobile device. But they're physically joining these film strips. So we get down to the exact frame. And we do the same thing with our other programs that we edit with, whether it's Premiere or Final Cut Pro or something else. And there's a magnifying glass going around here. A lot of time here. So it's the first time you've had film in your hands,
yes.
In small images.
For me,
yeah. So that's a trailer. That's what's known as a film trailer. Previews, basically. right? So 35 millimeter film, this is the exact specs of the strip of film that George Eastman developed. That became the standard, so it's 35 millimeter. And what you're looking at is, this is a car commercial, of course, for Oldsmobile, fine vehicle. And then you're seeing the squiggly lines there as that's soundtrack. It's a variable area soundtrack. So you have picture and sound combined that way.
What's the sound?
That sort of squiggly line that's there. Turn the lights up a little bit so you can look at those. So as that would go over the reader, that's the sound head reader. That variation in the area looks like a waveform that you might see in a video editing software. And then as we wrap up here, this is one of the more an iconic image here, series of images, sequence of images, sorry. So a bit exaggerated, but making the point here. And again, using the steps to sort of this collision, right, where there's a physical collision that's happening, and also through the editing, there's some repetition and some other shots like that happening. All right, so we have, coming back to this was the opening still that I had as we came in earlier today, right? So we have the sort of two values of all of our shots, right? So we have this photographic image, which may or may not have an idea for us. We could probably attach one to it. Think about it. This as the following shot, of course, maybe not where you were thinking it was going to go, but there it is. So I want to just introduce a few other filmmakers I think have been influential to me and to the field, and then we'll look at some clips before we wrap up. Is anybody familiar with Thelma Schoonmaker? She has worked almost exclusively for Martin Scorsese. They've collaborative partners since they were in college at NYU. If we think about the films of Martin Scorsese, what are some of the things that come to mind, noted for? Other than Hugo, you know. When we think about Raging Bull, Goodfellas, The Departed, hyper-masculine, right? Hyper-violent. Often critiqued for maybe an overextended sort of Italian-American bravado. Definitely lots of violence. This is his editor, is Thelma. And some not very bright journalist asked her after she won her second Academy Award in 2006 for The Departed, for editing, for film editing, had been nominated a number of times. Raging Bull was the other one from 1980. How does a nice lady like you deal with such violent images? And this was at the end of an interview, and she said, they're not violent until I get them. Right? I don't know what, you know, which was such a great answer. I think it really stuck it to the reporter, but also it's true, right? She hears action and she sees, you know, Leo DiCaprio get into character and, right, Jack Nicholson and the thing. Cut, you know, that's her experience. It's not until she edits them together. that's when the violence comes in, right? Again, juxtaposition, collision. Sally Menke, is anybody familiar with Sally? Sort of on this, I would say on the same spectrum, maybe on the other end, chronologically or something, I don't know. Quentin Tarantino, maybe you have, might be a little more familiar with his work than Scorsese's at this point. They work together the entirety of his career until her unfortunate passing. She did win an Academy Award for her work on 2009 Inglourious Basterds. Again, somebody who's known for highly stylized, very violent films. And the reason I include these editors in particular is that, one, I really like their work, and two, I didn't include this in the early cinema part of the presentation. Editing was essentially just cutting out the beginning when before the shot starts and then it ends. And unfortunately, given the way that work was divided in the era of early cinema, I'm talking, from 1900 to mid 20s. It was a low-level, low-paying job, an entry-level job. There was no training, and somebody got the idea that because the editing device, you would lean over a device, and the image would roll on a strip like that from the bottom to the top, right? Hey, that looks like a sewing machine, and women do all the sewing, so women should be editors. Was the approach, which, of course, is foolish for many reasons, and short-sighted and sexist and all that. I like having this sort of bookend that some of the most notable American Hollywood classic classical narrative filmmakers work exclusively with women, and there are a number of others, but again, these two are my favorite. So maybe my own sort of approach at updating a history or maybe some revision there. So let me pull up a few images here before we wrap. Moving images, even. So, is that familiar to anyone? Outdoors, streaming sunlight.
Museum.
I thought it was gonna be like some chill.
Film flare. Home movies, slow motion, church.
It starts out pretty.
Police.
It starts getting dark right around there.
Sex. Danger.
You, Sarah.
Home movies. Clan.
Scary. Scary
dad. Uncle. Is that blood? Film, being destroyed,
horror.
Underexposed, more sex, death.
Pennsylvania Rose. Road killer boomer.
Nightlife.
Nightlife.
Pool halls. Religion.
Mine's
sex.
South.
South.
Yeah, lots of.
Whole thing south.
Yeah.
Science.
Yeah, that's still wings.
Death, religion,
yeah.
Bugs, insects, transformation.
Smoke. She has dry ice in her mouth, probably.
Blood. True blood.
Rebirth.
New life. And they're like, nope, come back here.
Yeah, come back. And then show the cross again.
Lots of reasons to avoid the South.
Is it all in the South?
So the show is, thanks for your participation. So the show is, so that's a film strip like you have in your hand that's been treated with chemicals, and it's sort of animated. So it's, again, this decay and transformation that's going on. So the show is, set in Louisiana, Bon Temps Parish. It's set in present day, and it's about, explicitly, it's about vampires. I didn't see one vampire in there, but all the things that were mentioned, right? Transformation, rebirth, death, sex, all of those things came to mind. Religion, temptation, all right? Through the still images, they all had a very grainy film look to them. It's again here that we can physically see this film falling apart as it's animated. True blood, clearly we see that this is doesn't look like blood in particular, but that's what it's referencing. I really like doing that experiment. It's good. It's, again, it's one of my favorites. I think it's really effective in what
the
it's up to.
The moth coming out, is that symbolic of the vampire coming out at night?
Yeah, I think so. And the rebirth, right, that there's this transformation, the moth, right, the larva, the wings, right. They don't have wings on the show. So plug, I think it's a really great show. They had 6 seasons. It really deals with, it has a, it's a pretty notable subtext with a lot of contemporary social issues. They use terms like, that the, I think on the first episode, one of the first things that you hear, overheard on a television is that the vampires have come out of the coffin. So it's this idea, and they're, we think of the South maybe as not being as sophisticated socially or open-minded. That's sort of blown out of the water with the characters there. They're, it's a pretty socially advanced with our sort of human individuals. But we see these issues of bigotry and just ways that we sort of project our own shortcomings onto others in really ugly ways, nasty ways, through different supernatural characters. It's one of the first shows that deals with, it is the first primetime show that has a leading character that's in sort of in the throes of PTSD from Afghanistan in 2005. So he's sort of had just returned. So it's the first show that deals with that. So there's some other things going on there. I've never been one that interested in vampire shows in general or supernatural, and I was sick one summer, and this the second season was about to come on, and I was immobile, and so the whole first season sort of played while I had like a summer fever temperature. Maybe I thought I was transforming too. I don't know. I got sucked in. It was really great. It was really something. The subtext and the sort of some of the other social elements there that I was turned on to. It's a pretty whip smart. The first few seasons, the last few, it's okay. No more spoilers here tonight. Thanks. For coming tonight and for participating. If you don't want to put your film strips on your refrigerator, you can throw them on the table here. So I will, let's play us off here. We've always got to, you know, I also try to do the sort of vaudeville thing here too, right? That there's some level of showmanship going on. So we have a few more images here that we find later on in 256 colors, a film that we were looking at when we first came in, a sort of crowdsourced film made in 2013, a very limited a form that they're dealing with. But they go through these different themes and sort of talking with them and how to deal with images that you didn't shoot, that were crowdsourced. And how it would just completely change the meaning of this film if this goofy section was with some of the other sections. That sort of piano coffin was a flip book that was animated. If anything, it reminds you, and I've had this experience, I've only watched the film with an audience once. I also committed to watching it in pieces while at work. I thought that was fitting. So I could watch like a minute at a time. I'd only do it on Fridays. Things were a little slow Friday afternoons. And there was something about that experience, and it just reminded me of this appreciation of time that we have invested sitting in front of a screen. Yeah, that's a good one. So that's it. We'll end with a pratfall. Thanks.
Next Wednesday night, in this same space, at 7:30, will be the first non-media literacy event, and it will be a live showing of the Republican presidential candidates' debate with introductions and commentary by Professor Susan Richards, who's with us here tonight, on speaking styles, rhetorical strategies, and debate tactics that we will be seeing during the Republican presidential debate. We will not be talking about politics next Wednesday night, but we will be talking about politicians participating in a public debate. And in a month or two or three, we'll also have a night where we have a public showing of a Democratic Party presidential debate and have a similar evening like that then. So anyway, thank you for coming tonight. Hope to see you next Wednesday night for the Republican debate, whether you're a Republican or not. And we'll have two more events in November and two more events in December and all the rest of the year. And we'll have a wide variety of events and a wide variety of topics and a wide variety of formats. And we hope that as many people as possible can come to each of them. Thank you, and good night.